for Brooking. Brooking has made a face, and he's gone!
Looking back, when you first start off in the big worry, as I say, when I speak to my parents, and that was, well, am I going to make the grade? So the first thing, looking back, it's satisfying, I think, particularly from my parents as well.
Trevor Brooking is a player who was able to express himself, to give joy to the person who paid his 10 pennyworth in the stands or on the terraces, and was able to get people who were sitting down out their seats and those on the terraces jumping for joy, because he just had this creative talent which made people go, that's fantastic.
People love to see great players, and Trevor was a great player.
I speak to a lot of youngsters these days, and I say to them, if there's one player that you should model yourself on the field and off the field, then it would be Trevor Brooking.
He was world class, a world class player.
Trevor is just the ideal person for English football, for world football.
The fact I enjoyed my career, I think, was important. Enjoyed the football that we played at the club. Enjoyed the rapport with the supporters, and the sort of, I think, the mutual, you know, sort of rapport that we had with each other and the atmosphere at Upton Park and whatever. So that was an overall memory.
For Trevor was in the East End of London, near West Ham in Barking.
Well, I was born really in Barking, and you know, went to Ripple School, and we lived in a place called Salisbury Avenue. Born just in Upney Lane in Barking Maternity Hospital, but really I ended up going to Ripple. And jogged along there and played my football. It was one of those, it was quite a long run to school. And we, in those days, most of the East End lads would take a little tennis ball in their pocket and run along the pavements, just kicking it against the garden walls as you went. And then I used to have little races with my brother and kick a ball along with him. The idea of football in those days was unheard of. And there was a tennis ball, and if occasionally we managed to get the old fryer ball, the old plastic one, all well and good. But of course they used to occasionally get impaled on the old school railings, and you had to get the old soldering iron out and get it over and pump it up, hopefully, and it would survive for another couple of weeks. But mainly most of our early games were with a tennis ball, and of course it did increase your skill, because otherwise you were struggling. A few shoes bit the dust in the process, but it was good fun.
Just to give an indication as to how we'd improvise, we even used to play a knockout cup in our front room. I don't think Mum and Dad were too amused, but nevertheless, this is what we did. And we would actually take the cushions from a settee, put it either end, and then use a tennis ball. And we would have played something like 32 teams, have drawn a first round. we'd each be a team, and we'd probably have a five-minute game. And so then the game actually would include also throwing the ball up against the wall and then heading it in the direction of the goal, namely the cushion. And I say, I don't think Mum and Dad were too impressed.
One thing I used to like the boys to do was to kick with both feet for a start, because I was taught that at school. We used to play with a slipper on one foot on our good football and a football boot on the other when we was at school. And I thought that was a very good idea, because my feet were as good as one was as good as the other. So I thought, well, it was a good idea for the boys. And we used to take them out. I used to take them out and I'd go in goal and I'd make them shoot in with their bad foot. And actually, they both became as good as one another really at it. And they both developed 2 feet.
Obviously, we kicked around the goal, but then that was one against one, and then we needed to find that little bit of area, a bit bigger, where we could go with the friends. And our little breeding ground, so to speak, was the South East Essex Tech, which was a local school just around the corner. Naturally enough, we weren't supposed to be playing on there. So there was the main entrance of the school was right over one side where the caretaker was. So we used to hop over the fence and play in the far corner, which was a long wall for him. And so occasionally he did wander across and tell us to get off. But more often than not, we saw him come in, we could hop back over the fence. So that really was where we played most of our football. And when I say most of the football, it's either 3, 4, 5 a-sides, whichever ever many of the local lads turned up.
There would be anything from 10 to 30 children used to get over there at different stages. And we would have our own football matches, cricket. When the Wimbledon tennis used to be on, we'd even be playing tennis and have our own sort of Wimbledon championships. And we'd also even have our own athletics meetings around the outside. That was probably the area that Trevor didn't particularly excel at, as I'm sure some of the West Ham lads would would know why.
I remember in the second year, I was playing in a game in the playground, one of our lunchtime breaks. And I mean, at that stage, it was just, you know, lots of fun, and you're playing around. And a teacher called Mr. Clark came up and asked me my name, and I said, told him, and he said, got some football trials this afternoon for the school. Have you got your boots with you? Which I didn't have. So he said, well, why don't you go and get them? So I scarpered all the way home and missed the start of the lessons that afternoon. But got my football boots, because then only half hour later I was allowed to go off from the lesson to go to this football trial. Ended up going in the trials and ended up getting in the team sort of in the second year then, which was great really, because it meant I had 3 years in the school team. Yes, I mean, West Ham, you know, living in Barking was my nearest team, and really my earliest recollections would have been in the sort of late 50s, which were quite an exciting time for West Ham. Well, in the early days of going to matches, really you sort of moved around the ground, but I suppose the South Bank was more frequent. When I was very young, and it's occasionally, and everyone used to take, you might take little sort of the boxes, the old fruit box or something to stand on, because obviously you were a little bit small and you couldn't see. And then even in those days, if you got there a bit late, the younger ones of us would be shoved down the front and, yeah, come along here because you can't see there. I mean, the atmosphere was great, and so we'd all get all the youngsters down the front. At the end of the game, then you'd linger and meet up with your dad, who'd wait behind as well, and then just leave the ground afterwards. So it was always a very friendly club, good family atmosphere, and always get one or two wisecracks. I think, you know, East End humour is renowned, and so you'd have a chuckle even sometimes the game wasn't as good as you'd hoped.
Bobby Charlton was Trevor's schoolboy hero.
Goal number 5.
His, you know, his behaviour and general manner in which he sort of played the game was often thrown up as an example to youngsters. And so that was an important sort of lesson as well in those days. So I think Bobby Charlton, as much as anyone away from the club, was the person that you often went out in the back garden and tried to copy. You play your school games at primary level and you play your district matches, and then you go on to the second school, which happened to be Ilford County High, and I played then for the school teams. You go to district, and then if you're lucky enough, you go into other representative games. But I was lucky enough, I got to the district. Then we go into the Essex games, the county matches. And then you have London matches against Birmingham, Manchester, we played in those days, Liverpool. And then we got into actually the England schoolboy squad. But I was one of 16 boys who in that under 15 age group were selected, but I was one of the fringe five, really. I got a cap against West Germany, but wasn't one of the regular players. And yet of those 16 lads at sort of under 15, only three of us actually went on to get a career in the professional game. And yet at that age, we're, you know, all the scouts are after that 16 because they think they're going to be the ones to come through, but it doesn't always work out that way.
That was one thing about him. We knew that he was good at school, and that was why when West Ham were interested in him at 15 years of age, we didn't want him to leave.
And he didn't worry to leave, did he?
Fortunately, Trevor was, you know, he fell in with our idea straight away of staying on at school until he took his O-levels, and then he'd think about football, and that was what he did. He stayed on.
When I joined West Ham, it was in fact in then 65, which was, as I say, having finished my GCSEs. At school, I got my really 8 O-levels then, and then really had a 2-year apprenticeship. So, not knowing how the progress was going to go, I got what we term a day release to go to college to continue my studies. I did a business studies course there, which involved 4 subjects. So I got another 4 O-levels while I was there, and then got a couple of A-levels as well in accounts and economics, just, you know, as a safety valve while I was still going to giving this day release. So that was a nice cushion while the sort of young player was developing at the club.
There was competition early on because he was hot property, but being the type of man he is, once he'd said yes, that was it. He was coming, and nothing changed his mind.
But back in those days, to join your club, and especially the one that you actually supported as a young man, was a great day, a bit over awe, because suddenly Bobby Moore was coming into the same training ground, and Jeff Burst and Martin Peters, and really, you know, he just said hello to them, and that was a sort of quite nerve-wracking at the time. We had 60-odd professionals, and as a youngster, you know, yeah, you got changed, you did your training, but you didn't really come across the first team squad that regularly. So gradually, as you progressed, and then you might have an odd training session with the reserve squad, which was a big step up in those days, because you had one or two players who played in the first team, and so that was a good experience. But the first team setup still seemed a long way away because of the size of the squads at the ground. But it was exciting days because suddenly you realised you had a chance to make the grade.
Really, is it like most young players, they're in and out of the team, and much as I was at that age. So, and I think there was a bit of a problem in which position would really suit him. I think he came to the club as probably a forward player, and I think he was playing sort of halfway between midfield and forward at that stage. It wasn't really till he established himself really as a midfield player when he really, you know, his career took off.
Well, Trevor started at West Ham at the same time as me, basically, as apprentices. And we remember the first day we all came in, really, and Trevor has always given the appearance of a very sort of smart type of person. And we looked at him, really, and I wouldn't say he particularly looked like a footballer, which obviously everyone's been proved wrong over the years.
Well, I suppose my first memory really was the first day I went there. It was 66, it was the World Cup year, and it was a great euphoria at that time at the training ground, etc. I was a YTS boy, well, it was an apprenticeship in those days. And in pre-season with all clubs, the youth team joining with the first team and young professionals. And the thing that stood out to me was his ability on the first day. You know, you had the Bobby Moores and the Hurst and the Peters, and, you know, quality players at West Ham. And I remember my father said to me, what do you think of it? You know, what's Hurst, Peters and Moore like? I said, Dad, the player that really sticks out to me is a fella called Brooking.
I think Trevor Brooking has always been recognisable as outstanding talent. I mean, he was a very gifted player, and he's an exceptional individual. And I think even in his early days, you could sense that there was a tremendous career ahead for Trevor. And also at the same time that there was something tucked away in that framework that made him a very, very special person.
I always remember it being up at Turf Moor on my opening game. It's I think it's traditional, certainly in those early years, that quite often they give you your debut, whoever, whichever club you were at an away ground, because sometimes there's a bit more pressure on you at home. All family and friends come along, and the supporters say, you know, who's this young fellow, what's he going to do? So it's nice perhaps to do it away from home, where, you know, there's not quite as many people putting you under the spotlight. And it was a 3-3. I mean, it was an exciting game. I quite enjoyed it. I had people like Ronnie Boyce, Martin Peters around me, who, as I say, were sort of heroes as being midfield players. So it was great to play with them. Although, strangely enough, later on in those next 2 or 3 years, more of my opportunities in the first team, because of the sort of players that we had at the club, happened to come more towards the front as a forward player and as a striker. And possibly that might have been why those first 3 or 4 years then, I had spells in the team, but then we're out again and back in, and never quite really able sort of to establish myself in the lineup as regularly as I would have hoped.
But once in the team, Trevor became one of West Ham's favourite sons, with midfield skills that graced Upton Park for the best part of 20 years.
People always ask, you know, at times, why for the 19 years at the club did you stay at West Ham, and supporters, and the fact that, you know, as a youngster I was a West Ham supporter, and the atmosphere of the club did play a big part. The directors were very much a family, the Terms family and Reg Pratt as well, and I think the club was run in that fashion. They had a stability about the managers. I mean, I only had 2 managers in 19 years, which is unheard of in most clubs. And I think, you know, West Ham supporters, wherever you go in the country, always stay as West Ham supporters. They don't sort of switch because they live in the locality and then start supporting the locals. So they are very loyal, and it seemed to just engender that bit of loyalty on the other side.
Trevor was a great player. He conducted himself well off the pitch. I mean, there was never any scandal off the pitch. And some of the modern day professionals now, they seem to go hand in hand with scandal or whatever, you know, controversy. But there was never anything like that with Trevor. He was a gentleman on the field and a gentleman off it, and I think the crowd knew that and appreciated it.
I think probably, talking through myself, I would say that the support at West Ham is marvellous. They've always encouraged players, particularly forward players, to be creative, forward players and midfield players. And I had a good career at West Ham. I could have moved on to other clubs, but I was quite happy with my career. With England level, and Trevor was playing for England and recognised as one of the top midfield players in the world, and I felt he must have felt he fulfilled all his ambitions with West Ham, and I'm sure that exactly the same as I did.
I mean, I don't know, I've got a babysitter and she wrote to him years ago, and he wrote back to her, and she's over the moon with Trevor. I mean, Trevor Brooking walks in water and everything she says. I mean, it's unbelievable that she's followed him, and she's here again today, and obviously she just married him, you know what I mean? Look out, Hilker.
I don't think even now, or West Ham, we haven't replaced him, and probably may never will replace him. He had this great ability to sort of get the ball and just struck people off. He was quick. We used to say it before the game, okay lads, we had all people to mark, different people, but Trevor was always left on his own, because all we have to do is get the ball and give it to Trevor. And lots of games that was the case, because he was such a good player, and undoubtedly, you know, world class player.
The important factor was that I enjoyed my football and time at the club, because when football becomes your profession, you know, it can be slightly different, and there's more pressure, and you know, you have to sort of each week turn in performances. But the manner and the style of West Ham's game meant I enjoyed the style that they played. And then I think, you know, generally speaking, just the fact that you're happy at a place is very important.
In the 60s, Upton Park was full of good players, and Trevor found it hard to claim a first team place.
So I went to see Ron Greenwood and said, look, you know, I feel, and to be fair, I was in my early 21, 22 almost coming up, which these days you should be established in the team. And he said, all right, if we can sort of see what happens with the relegation side, if you still feel the same way in the summer, you know, then we'll talk about it then.
During that period of time, he got so worked up about it that he thought a move would do him a bit of good. So he came to see me, and his father came to see me, and his they were a bit concerned. And I said, well, if that's what you want. So we put him on the transfer list.
Trevor's problems revolved around who would partner Bobby Moore in the heart of the West Ham defence. Alan Stevenson, or another expensive signing to the team, Tommy Taylor, who had arrived from Orient.
He played Alan Stevens, who was fit by then, alongside Bobby Moore, and Tommy Taylor played in midfield. Now, as luck would have it for me, they lost the opening three games, and Tommy was obviously not happy playing midfield. And so Tommy then went back into the back four alongside Bobby as they'd finished tail end of last season. And Alan Stevenson actually was left out and was the later on leave the club. But the opening then came in midfield, and I had a run in the side then when we sort of only lost one in 16 games, and in fact the game we lost was to Manchester United 4-2 when Georgie Best really beat us on his own with a hat-trick. Although in fact the score in that game, nobody ever remembers the Best's hat-trick, but you always remember your own goals. But it was great to score at Old Trafford. That was my first goal at Old Trafford.
And from then on, Trevor was a regular in the team.
The beauty about Trevor Brooking was you could give him the ball, even when he was tightly marked. You knew he could either let it run across his body or do something to get himself out of trouble. So you always had an easy ball to play to him, if you like. And you knew even if he had one or two round him, he'd have no problem sort of either laying it off early or as I say, dummying somebody and making something happen with him.
Well, Bobby Moore was, you know, a great influence on all players at that time, and so it was a strange period, really, I suppose, when he eventually left the club, went on to Fulham. But it did then leave the door open for another sort of great captain to emerge under Billy Bonds, and really then we were lucky to get an early opportunity in Bill's captaincy era to go back to Wembley. And the irony being that the opponents were to be Fulham. It wasn't a classic match. In fact, as often happens, it was a goalkeeping mistake helped us. The goalkeeper of Fulham was a man called Peter Mellor, very experienced. A couple of shots just bundled away from him, rebounded off his chest, and we had a lad playing up front that season, Alan Taylor, and he got two in the cup final, so it was a dream season for Alan, and there we ended up getting the cup. It's one of the funniest things now, looking back on it, is because you keep photos and whatever. They're the haircuts. I mean, we all had long hair. I mean, we looked like musketeers when you think back to it. I had a Engelbert Humperdinck look with the old long sideburns and that, which my children take the mick out of now. And Billy Bonds looked like sort of D'Artagnan there with his long buccaneering beard and hair. And Frankie Lampard the same. Yeah, Bonzo was a great leader. I mean, always had been. I mean, probably for me, he was the best captain I played. I mean, Patsy Holland, who was a character, I mean, who came up through the youth team. Great laugh, Pat, and you're great for dressing room atmosphere.
Well, it's all according to what quality you're looking for a player. I mean, and everyone's got their own quality. Some like people who can pass a ball, Glenn Oddle. Some like people who are good defenders, good headers. I always love to see a fellow who can beat a man. And I think if you look at the great players, world-class players, Pelé, Cruyff, Maradona, you name it, Best, he'd come into that category that he could beat a man. And if I was a fan on the terraces and I had to pay money, then I would pay money to see a man who could beat a player. I would get that enjoyment. And Trevor had that strength. And that's what really stood out for me.
Well, European football was one of the big bonuses of getting to a cup final, because, you know, people always and asked me years later, why did you stay at West Ham? Didn't you want to play in Europe that much more? But we played only two occasions, but they were memorable. I mean, it was a new experience. We came through those early rounds and then got to the semi-final where we had to play Eintracht Frankfurt.
Chipped it again towards Brooking. And it's there! Brooking has done it! That's the goal West Ham wanted. And Trevor Brooking is the man who got it.
Keith Robson. Mad Robbo is was effectively known amongst the lads. He was a real Geordie character. Bit fiery though. But he got a goal for us on the night. And then I was lucky enough to get two. I mean, probably that was, in as far as my club games, one of my favourites.
Brooking, beautiful timing. Still Brooking. Yes, number three. Magnificent.
Sadly, the final against Anderlecht did not go so well.
And they ended up winning 4-2, which was disappointing because the fact that we hadn't sort of finished high enough and hadn't got any cup competition, we had to win that trophy to get in the following year. We didn't. We lost the final, and so we were out of Europe again. And we had a change then in the management. Ron Greenwood became general manager, and John Lyle took over as the team manager. And we had, as I say, a spell where we were still entertaining, but we were conceding too many goals. You know, the people used to take mick on two things, really. One, if we went past Watford Gap, we'd probably lose because we were not renowned then as travellers. And then sort of, you know, we were very adverse to crosses. Any high balls into the penalty area usually caused problems and ended up with goals. So we did go down. That summer was probably one of my lowest points of my career because it was an uncertain period for myself and obviously the family. People were speculating then that I would leave the club.
He just knocked on my door and came in and very simply said, I want to stay at the club, but I realise going in the second division may be a problem financially. If I'm sold, I'll understand.
And he was a little concerned about the fact that he might have to move because it might affect his England position. And John had a word with me and we had a word with him. And I said, well, look, it doesn't alter any your ability. Whatever your division in, you're still the same type of player. So that reassured him and he stayed on at West Ham and, of course, had a great career there.
The decision really to stay at the club then, and we had 3 years in the second division, was weirdly turned out to be probably the key decision because it was our most successful spell for a while. Big significance was the arrival of Phil Parkes. I mean, Parkes, he was a great keeper and then certainly proved it in the years that he stayed with West Ham. Ray Stewart turned up soon afterwards, affectionately known as Tonka with the lads, because he was a fairly aggressive player. But when we went back to Dundee United, who we signed him from, the lads all said, oh, hello, Tonka, and that was his nickname, so we found out what the reason was. I mean, it was he had a heavy touch. I mean, supporters will chuckle because you know, his passing at times, whether it be a 10-yard or a 50-yard pass, he sometimes weighted the same way, and we always wind him up. And that was how his Tonka nickname came, because of the heaviness of his touch. Although if he's taken a penalty kick, he certainly was very effective in tucking those away.
I suppose it's an experience you never forget. He's got so much natural ability and knowledge of the game. It's you've got to learn something from him. If you don't learn something from him, then you're in the wrong game.
Albie Martin was emerging through the youth system, and by then Billy Bonds had moved into the back four, so that gave us the solidness. We then had Frank Lampard, you know, his experience and consistency at left back in the forward and the attacking area. Stuart Pearson came, David Cross, I mean, Norman, as he was as again known with the lads, and Psycho, as he was affectionately known with the supporters, he became a popular figure. And then later on, with a year or two of that success, we signed Paul Goddard, who was an excellent forward and a great sort of foil for David Cross up front. So gradually we made the signings and the sort of platform of the side emerged then.
In any great player, there's a subtlety and a genius about him, and we had some very, very talented lads, all totally honest, fully committed and very loyal to West Ham. But I think
to have any side that will be really successful and have individuals in your club that are going to become internationals, you need the subtlety and the class and the genius. He had great knowledge, great awareness of when to play the ball quickly, when to let the ball run, where other people were on the field, a total control of what I call the football field, and Trevor certainly had that. You know, I'm sure he would be the first to say that Billy Bonds or Frank Lampard, people like that, did a lot of hard work, made a lot of tackles for him. But, you know, the first thing and the obvious thing was to do was to give it to Trevor Brooking and let him try and produce something from there.
Trevor has that knack of being able to beat you either side, left or right, score goals, but you never dislike him for it. There's some people say, well, you've got to kick him, you've got to get hold of him, and you've got to... But he always did things the right way, the fair way. As a player, he's the ideal guy for anybody to follow, a young player. Watch Trevor Brooking as an example.
He was very strong and deceptive. He was quicker than probably what he looked. People didn't understand that. And he was very hard to knock off the ball, and he was capable of making runs down the sides of the penalty areas and supplying crosses from either side. And he had this ability of, although a defender would stand off him, he had this ability of just swerving balls around him to the near post, which was a thing we worked on a lot at West Ham and produced a lot of goals for myself.
One other player who then had emerged into the first team and really was a brilliant player and who I loved playing with in midfield was Alan Devonshire. I mean, he became a key influence in the midfield department over the next few years. And his devastating pace and acceleration was an extra dimension to our game. And he had a great game in that semi-final replay up at Everton. We got to the final and really we had nothing to lose because Arsenal... The glamour side had played four matches with Liverpool in the semi-final. I mean, everyone said whoever got through that must win it.
Yeah, it was a very difficult opponent, but always a joy to play against, really. Very sporting. But when he was on his day, he was a very dangerous opponent. He was a top-class player.
They had Liam Brady, a great player, as we all know, and was to find out later on, because when he joined West Ham, he was a super player for Arsenal. That was just before he was going to go off to Italy. Graham Rix was alongside him. And Brian Noddy Talbot, the old Ipswich player who'd gone to Arsenal, was another midfield player. The game, you know, started in the usual frantic fashion. And at that stage, you don't want to concede an early goal and both sides started. And then Dev suddenly broke on the left in his usual terrific acceleration that he had. And took him away and took him to the byline. And it was crossed all beyond the far post and Pat Jennings sort of came out and sort of helped it on its way. And it was only half cleared, really. And it fell, first of all, to sort of David Cross, who then tried to sort of knock it back in, and it was blocked by Big Willie Young, I think it was. And it went out to Stuart Pearson. I mean, instinctively, you know, if you can divert it towards the goal, the chance has got to go in because of the power of Stuart's shot. So it was, if I'd have stood still, it was just going to miss me on the right-hand side. So I just sort of fell backwards and just sort of guided it towards the goal. I mean, there's no case of aiming it for a particular area. I knew I was in the middle of the goal. And fortunately, as luck would have it, it bypassed Pat Jennings and sort of flew into the net.
He notched that day the only goal of the game. West Ham were in the second division at the time. But they were a very good side with Billy Bonds and Trevor Brooking, Stuart Pearson, people like that, experienced players. But not only did Trevor score, but he also had a wonderful match. And you know, we weren't capable of fighting back after Trevor got that goal.
He scored a goal with his head, which is unusual for him. We went 1-0 up, basically, a bit against the run of play. And after that, we played quite well and ended up beating Arsenal. I think it was 1-0, and we were a second division side, and Arsenal were one of the top teams in the country.
But David Cross is still down. Trevor Brooking was down as well.
When he scored the goal, we were down the far end, and so it was not easy to see it. And we could see the ball knocked across. And then it end up in the net, and they all players started running around congratulating each other. And it was at that stage we thought, well, it looks as if it's Trevor. And it was not, we were not too sure how it had gone in. The last thing we would have expected was it'd been through as a result of him heading it in.
The underdogs have done it again.
It was a great goal, but I don't think he really realised he'd done it himself, really. A natural instinct, shall we say.
He scored with one of his rare diving headers, and we said he was trying to clear the ball, actually, at the time. But that was fantastic for him. It sort of crowned his day, basically, because I think at that time it took a little bit of stick from a certain Mr. Clough.
Cup final day had not started too well when a reporter phoned Trevor with a message. He told him,
I've been asked to ring you up because the Daily Express are a bit embarrassed. They've got an article coming out Saturday morning which Cluffy has done for them, and in it he's been a bit sort of unkind to yourself as well as the club in general, saying, you know, we should be worried about cup finals. We're stuck in the second division. You should be more interested in, for your supporters, getting them into the first division. And then me personally said he often sort of floats like a butterfly and stings like one too. And that evening on the TV they said, you know, did Cluffy's criticism stir you on to play well in the cup final? But it didn't, because you don't need motivation for a cup final. I mean, it was great to play in it. I mean, the thing that you were upset about at the time was if you played badly, people might have thought, oh, Cluffy said he wasn't that good a player. But I mean, it didn't, you know, you didn't need that incentive, but it probably deep down was satisfying that it had gone well in that particular match.
We used to laugh at him about his heading and what have you, but he said it's the one occasion that season that he headed the ball and he scored the winning goal against Arsenal. So that sticks in your mind. But no, I think the great thing about Trevor was no matter where he went to play and however important the game was, he would play and perform to his very best of his ability. There were no easy games for Trevor. There was always a standard set, and I think the great players set the highest standards. So you could go to grounds, what I call unfashionable grounds, and still see Trevor Brooking produce quality football. And I think that's really what endeared him to the fans of this country. It wasn't just about playing for West Ham. It was that people admired his attitude and approach to the game, and of course his great skill.
I'd popped up as far as England. It was concerned sort of late on in Elf's reign, really, and was in the squad, although never featured for playing-wise.
Trevor proved himself to Sir Ralph at under-23 level and then progressed to the senior team.
Your first England game is terrific. I mean, to get into the squad is good, then to play your first game. The best moment, I mean, people have talked about in the past. I remember in the early 70s, England don't have the passion that sort of the Welsh and the Scottish do and that. But it's not the case. I mean, all England players want to play. The great problem at England level is, A, to build up an understanding with players that you're only together for 3 days before you play the match. And secondly, you know, then is to feel that you're going to get a good run in the team. So as if you try things and it doesn't come off, you're not going to be dropped that you had a bad game. And really the reason you're in the England team is because of the way you've expressed yourself at that level, at club level. But it's not easy to make the transition and have the same confidence to do the same international.
By 1978, Trevor had made that transition, and with Keegan, formed an essential part of the team.
I think my best spell, no doubt, for England was under the sort of managership of Ron Green, but he knew me so well from West Ham, the way I liked to play, and gave me that sort of role. So probably from 78 to 82, four and a half years under Ron were the best games as far as England were concerned.
Trevor made it look easy, and that's the secret of, like I always used to say, simplicity is genius, and it is, you know, because to make anything look simple, you've got to be a genius, and he did that.
Trevor and myself had a good understanding at West Ham, on the field, playing-wise, and I think Trevor went on to play with Keegan at England level, and I think he found a great understanding with Kevin Keegan as well.
Flick wide for Phil Deal on the far side there. Koppel, in again now, Paul McDermott, can he cross it in there? Brooking! And he's there!
Oh, brilliant.
England have scored.
We had one of those games where everything went right and certain myself. You know. I got one in the first half, a goal, which was a bit of a bobbler. But they all count, as they say.
Neil with a chance to cross it in there once more, but maybe he'll try and find Koppel down that flank. No, it's in here for Keegan. Played back for Brooking. Terrific goal! A terrific goal by Brooking, and England are back in the lead!
I hit it well from the moment it left my foot. I knew it was in. And we won that game 3-1. Gave us a glimmer of hope for qualifying then, and we did then win the home leg against Hungary 1-0 and qualified for the 82 World Cup.
He knows what he wants to do with the ball before he gets it, and that's always the sign of a great player. And especially in the days when he played with Kevin Keegan, the two of them were sort of telepathic, and Trevor always seemed to be able to pick out Kevin, and that was two great footballing brains working together. It was called Hadley because he is a gentleman, and it was actually Kevin Keegan who was always good at one or two jokes around the dressing room, and it was Kevin at one training session that brought up the name of Hadley. I think it was basically because he very rarely got dirty in training, and always immaculate, and always wearing the Squire's sports jacket in those days in the 70s. So it was Kevin Keegan that brought up the name Hadley, and it certainly stuck with all the England players who were in the squad.
England looking much more impressive in this second half as Keegan takes a run on, and a 1-2, and a great goal by Keegan!
Sadly, injury was to rob England of the talents of Brooking and Keegan.
Well, the 82 World Cup was probably, again, one of the big disappointments in my career, really. Having sort of fluctuated between would we get there and would we not, and having got to Spain, and it being my last opportunity, it was very frustrating to end up with a groin injury, which really kept us out until the last 25 minutes of the last game.
We couldn't use Keegan, we couldn't use Brooking, and they were the two stalwarts of the side. They were the engine of the side, really, and it was a great tragedy, really, because I think we'd have gone on right to the end.
When we came back to the First Division that following season, I mean, for me, we were a really good First Division side.
Brooking. Got to stop him soon. Oh, just wide. What a great run by Brooking. Brooking again. Really in the mood. Oh, and that's a delightful ball. If Walford could get there. Left foot in a good one. And Pike. And scores. 1-0. Pike. Brooking. Swindlehurst and Cotty are up as well. That's the ball for Cotty. Inch perfect. A brilliant goal.
But the balance of the team was fatally upset when Alan Devonshire suffered a serious injury and a car crash took Alvin Martin from the team.
So that was sad and probably had an influence on the fact that, you know, that summer then, the end of the 83-84 season, I decided to call it a day. Most people said you should be carrying on, but I thought Dev wasn't going to be there. Myself, Bill and Frank were a year older, and it wouldn't be easy the following season to get amongst trophies. So I thought it would be nice to finish while things were going well. I suppose two great days, really. The Saturday was the last Saturday game when, in fact, Little Warren was the mascot. And really then, Nottingham Forest being the opposition, I thought a lot of the fact that they gave me an engraved piece of cut glass, which, you know, to commemorate sort of the time in the game. And then we had a last fixture which was rearranged on the Wednesday, and we were playing Everton. But the great fact about that night was, it was ovation and everything when it went off, and it felt great. Afterwards, as I say, with it being the last, our season had sort of petered out down in the dressing room, and was given one or two of the younger lads, you know, one summer, you know, about, you know, we should do show. And as it happened then, Brian, sadly, you know, his illness since has passed away, but was one of the Kearns family, poked his head out of the room and said, but he said, there's all the crowd have been chanting Trevor's name and would like him to come back on the pitch. So I was half in the socks and went out there, and I was absolutely amazed that it really did look as if not one person had left. and then got us to do the lap of honour and picked up scarves and different things all the way around. And that was a very emotional night, really, and a wonderful send-off that I couldn't have, you know, wished for better. Having had the background of, you know, good influences from a manager's John Lyle and Ron Greenwood, people often ask why you didn't go into management. It's just I wanted to get to 35, 36 and have an alternative, because, you know, when you're playing and you see articles about players who, you know, struggled since giving up the game and whatever, and I was a little bit concerned that having got to 35, 36, the only thing I could do was coaching and management, and it would be a bit restricted. While I'd been playing, I was lucky enough to go into a little business, a binding business in Stratford Coldbrook, which jogged along and was gradually progressing while I was playing still. And then when it came to the time when I was finishing, there was an opening in the radio, which I took up, and then having done that for a season or two, the TV approached us to do a similar role for them. And then a sort of a journalistic opening came, and so I developed other areas. But it's not one of those things that when you pack up you can say, right, I'm going to go into radio, TV or journalism, because you've got to wait for the openings or the opportunities to come. But the fact that they developed, was I was fortunate, because it enabled me to keep the connection with the game. When I first got married, really, then Hilke, my wife, when we first met, didn't really know that much about football. I mean, always wind up, well, in Finland they wouldn't.
When I met Trevor, I didn't know much about football, and I felt I got two choices, to be completely ignored or get involved, and I decided to get involved.
She was working before, you know, we started a family, and in fact was earning more than me in my younger days at West Ham. And so we, you know, we worked together then, and probably later on it makes you appreciate things more when things go a bit better. But in the early years, it was a struggle, and she encouraged us, and actually turned out later on to be my sternest critic, I suppose.
He's the most blessed man and very easygoing to live with, and at the same token, most untidiest person I've ever come across. People find it very difficult too, because normally he looks immaculate, but on the whole, as I said, very untidy, but very easy to live with.
Now, weekends are more likely to be spent at the local stables with his family, watching daughter Colette riding, than preparing for a game.
It's difficult for them, perhaps, at certain stages, if they have somebody who, whichever walk of life, who then gets projected quite a lot in the media side. I think it was lucky the way the two ages came. Colette, my daughter, was first to come, and being girls and daughters, they're not as interested in the football scene. Now, my son Warren then came along 3 years later, and by the time I finished playing, he was still a little tot.
On Sundays, charity work and organising matches takes up a lot of Trevor's time now, encouraging friends like Billy Bonds, Frank Lampard and Liam Brady to play in front of smaller crowds than they saw at Upton Park, but with all the old commitment and skill.
I've known him a long while, Trevor, and football-wise, terrific player, great player. Off the field, I mean, he's the first to do anything for anybody. I mean, he'll always provide, and he's available to do things, but he'll do them. He wouldn't hesitate to do them. And I think those two little things really sum the boy up.
Once he had the ball, then boy, you beware, because he was capable of making you look a fool in one moment.
He is the perfect ambassador for the greatest game in the world.
He was a gentleman on the field and a gentleman off it.
I think it's fair to say that his whole career really has been a delight for everyone involved with him.
The way he played the game, the way he's conducted himself,
just made him a favourite for everybody.
Very proud of him
still, yes. What we like about him is he hasn't changed over the years, you know. He's still Trevor to us, and he's still easygoing as well.
He basically is the first gentleman of football to me.
Thank you.